Hello everyone, welcome to second lecture of FS101 course. I'm Shikhar Gulati. I will be teaching you basics of Java today. So agenda for today is, we'll be covering five items today. We'll start with the basic of Java, just to understand we all know what Java as a language is all about. Then we will move on to structure of a Java class. We'll talk about the different things that make a Java class. Then we will cover packages in depth, how to name a package, different styles that you can follow to create packages, like package by feature, package by layer, or package by type. So we'll cover that as well. Then we will talk about access modifiers in Java. So we'll talk about public, private, protected, and default. And we will end this session with non-access modifier. So we'll cover three non-access modifier today. One is static, then other is abstract, and third is final. As always, slides are on this bit.ly link. So I follow a convention where the slide name is bit.ly/fs101day02. So yesterday was day 01. So tomorrow it will be day 03. For next couple of weeks, or at least 3-4 weeks, the main tool chain that we will be using will be Java 8, IntelliJ IDEA, Git, VS Code. As we move along, I will probably add few more tools into this list as well. So Typora is mainly a markdown editor. So there will be times that you will be writing some documentation. So I write documentation in markdown, and I use this editor to do that. It's a free editor. It's not an open source, but it's free, so anybody can download it for free and use it. VS Code is the editor that we normally use if I just have to change one file or probably not work with the Java code, then I use VS Code. IntelliJ is for working with the Java code. And we will be using the JDK 8 version. So I'm not covering Java 9, 10, 11, 12 right now. I'm only talking about Java 8. And Git is a version control system that we covered yesterday as well, or in our previous lecture. So let's start with the question, what is Java? I know most of you are already aware of Java, but it still helps to go over what Java as a language has to offer. So Java is an object-oriented language, but it is not one of the languages which is pure. So when we say pure, we talk about a language which supports, which has everything as object. So in Java, we don't have everything as object. So we have primitive types like integer, float, character, short, etc. Those are not objects. So those are the primitive native types that Java has. Java is a platform independent language, so you don't have to compile your code on multiple platforms. So you can compile your code once and then you can use it on any platform. So this is the reason Java is called Vora, or write once, run everywhere, runs anywhere. It is a statically typed language, so all the type checking is done at the compilation time. So in Java, you can't get away from types, you have to specify the types. Java type inference is becoming strong, but it's still not at the level of the other languages which provides a better type inference. So Java still requires a lot of placing. You still have to provide types in few places, in lambdas or in diamond operator that Java has. You don't need to provide type, like when you're creating a list of string, list equal to new array, so you don't have to provide the type there. But apart from that, you have to provide type more or less in Java everywhere. Java has automatic memory management using the garbage collectors. Java is suitable for writing multi-threaded code. So Java has primitives like threads from the start, from Java 1.1 days. And it is one of the most popular programming language. So it is a good language to invest your time and energy on. So few days back, I found a link by IEEE which talked about the rating of a language. So Java is at rank 2. Python is mostly at rank 1, mainly because of the lot of interest in the data science and the artificial intelligence work that has been happening. So the language, so the libraries like Keras or TensorFlow are becoming more and more popular, and more developers want to try Python or use Python. So that's one of the reason Python has become a lot more popular. But Java is still the main language that you will find being used in the enterprises. JavaScript is at position 6. I think one language that probably you should also look at is Go, which is at 10. So Go is also picking a lot in enterprises as well. So let's talk about what it means to be an object-oriented programming language. So it means for a language to mean an object-oriented programming language, it means that you can use it to model real-world entities. So if you're building a to-do application, you can have entity like a to-do or a task, which will be used to model a real-world object, in the world. An object has a state and a behavior. That's the two things that an object has. In Java, there are two types of there are two styles in which you can implement object-oriented programming. Java implements something called class-based style. So class-based style of object-oriented programming is the one in which inheritance occurs via defining of the classes. So as you know, in Java, everything resides inside a class. So Java implements that. But it's not the only style of object-oriented programming. JavaScript, which is another language, implements something called a prototype-based programming language, in which you can do everything just using objects as well. So in that, inheritance occurs only by object. So as you can see, there are multiple ways to do object-oriented programming. So Java has something called class-based style that what Java follows. And there are many languages that also follow the same. I think one thing that most people know as well, and it's important to keep in mind, Java is platform independent, and this is one of the reason Java became very popular in early days, and that's why many enterprises picked it up, because you don't want to implement the same thing in different platforms. So if something works in Windows, you want to ensure that it also works in Linux or Mac. So by platform independence, it means that you have to compile your source code once. So if I compile the source code on my Mac machine, I can take that binary compiled code and I can run it on a different machine as well. So all that magic is taken care by something called a JVM. So JVM is something that boots up when you type Java command, which is implemented per operating system. So on Mac, there will be a different JVM. On Windows, there will be a different JVM. On Linux, there will be a different JVM. That is specific to a hardware and the operating system. A JVM interpret bytecode to machine specific instruction for execution. So again, there is some part of interpretation that happen in the JVM as well. So you get the bytecode, but JVM also interprets it at runtime as well. This is the reason when you are running a Java program, for initial sometimes the program might be slow, because interpretation is happening as in during that time. So normally you have to warm up the JVM, and then you will start having consistent performance with Java. This is the reason Java is called write once, run anywhere, or Vora. So as always, whenever you're trying to get into a new language, it's always good to start with the Hello World, because the Hello World can tell you in few lines of code, a Hello World program can tell you what kind of programming language promotes. So if you look at the Hello World in Java, this is the Hello World program in Java. So as you can see, we have everything residing in a class. So class is one thing that you need to have. Then you have a main method, and then you have a system.out.println. So anybody who is trying to get into Java has to know about classes, has to know about a main method. If you're using something like a Python or a JavaScript, you just have to write console.log if you're using JavaScript, or just printf or print function in Python. But in Java, things have to reside in a Hello World or in a class. So what Java does is, so you have two things in Java which are most prominent that you will always you will need to be aware of. One is called a Java C, which is the compiler. The second is the Java, which is the runtime execution, which is the JVM or the interpreter that you have. So you take your source code file hello.java, give it to a compiler, it will compile it and give you the binary code, which is the class file, it is the bytecode that you have, which you pass it to Java, and your execution happens. So that's how things happen in Java. As I already talked about, in Java everything resides inside a class, so you can't have helper functions sitting outside of a class. So this is the reason Java is normally not used to writing scripts, because that's not the way Java is useful. So Java is basically useful when you're building a bigger program which require a lot of modularity, which require a lot of packages, then it makes more sense. But for one-off script, Java is too heavyweight to use. Also, it is not interpretable as well, and that's another reason. So scripting languages are more interpretable in nature, so that make them more useful for writing scripts. Every executable program need to have a main method, so you need to have a main method with that signature, like string, args, until unless you can't do anything in Java. Java uses curly braces, so that's what you need to know. To denote the sections of a code, like a class or a method declaration statements end with semicolon. Functions must have a return type. If you don't have a return type, you have to specify something called a void. So like public static void means, so that is the void that we have. I like looking into history of things, so I was trying to find what is the history of Hello World. As it turns out, Hello World also has a history. So it was first, so the tradition of using Hello World came from a book which was published in 1978 called the C Programming Language, the C Programming Language, and it picked up from another book which was published in 1974 by Bell Laboratories, which was written by Kernighan, which is Programming in C, a Tutorial. So this is basically the source of all this Hello World. But there it was written in small cases. Now normally we use in the Pascal case or the capitalized case. Another thing that is important to know about Java is that it is a language which is statically typed and compiled language. And I think I just want to spend some time on what the statically typed and compiled language means. And I think this will become clear by looking at an example. Let's look at this example, static typing example. So you have a main method here which is calling a method called foo. Foo takes an integer a. If the number is greater than a, it prints hello. If the number is greater than, if a is greater than 0, it prints hello. If otherwise, it assign a to string, string str, and then just prints the hello str. Think about it, what will happen? I will give a few seconds, think about it, what will happen. As it turns out, in a language like Java, this will not even compile. So code will fail to compile at this number line, line number 13, where it says the string str. So this is the squiggly line that we are getting. So this is a screenshot of IntelliJ. So it is before even we can run this code, we are getting the compilation error. The reason is that the compiler is doing the type checking is me ensuring that can an integer be assigned to a string. The answer is no, so you basically get a compiler error. So program does not have to run, so we can get these kind of errors sooner in the life cycle of a project. It saves a lot of time and effort as well. So when we talk about static typing, we're talking about that types of all the variables are known at the compile time, that is before the program runs. Compiler can figure out types of expression as well. So if the compiler knows that a and b are integers, it can automatically deduce that a plus b is also an integer. Static typing prevents a large class of bugs from infecting a program, so it basically helps improve the productivity as well as the quality of product. In a broader sense, static typing is a form of static checking. Static checking means finding the bugs automatically before the program runs. A lot of big organizations like Google, Facebook, or Uber, or other Silicon Valley or Bay Area companies spend a lot of time on the building static analysis tools. So Google has in Java, they have a tool called error prone, which can find bugs in your code. Initially we also have something called find bugs, something called spot bugs. Facebook has a tool called infer. Uber also has a tool which can detect null pointer exceptions. So a lot of people are trying to do checks at the compilation time so that they can safeguard their developers, and it really can save a lot of effort as well as money as well. Everything finally translates down to money and productivity. So anything that you can do at the compilation time helps a lot. Compiled means that code is converted to efficient bytecode before execution. So that would happen in Java. So when you compile a Java program using Java C, it gets converted to the bytecode that you have, and type checks are also performed at the compile time. So think about what is the opposite of statically typed compiled language. The obvious answer is dynamically typed interpreted language. So think about any language that you think is dynamically typed interpreted language. So first thing first, Java is not one of them. As we talked about, Java is a statically typed compiled language. One example of dynamically typed interpreted language is Python. An interpreted language is a type of programming language for which most of its implementation execute directly and freely, so which means that when you are running the program, instructions are being executed at that point itself. So there is no bytecode that the program basically is running through the source code itself. So there is no machine language instruction that in case of Java we basically create. So in case of something like Python, we don't have that. So now this is a similar code to the code that we saw in Java. This is a Python code. Again, we have a function foo, which if a is, which takes a argument called a, which has a method parameter a. If a is greater than 0, it prints hello. If a is less than 0, less than equal to 0, then it will do a string equal to hello plus a. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to concatenate a along with hello. So if I pass foo 2, so this line of code will execute, and if I pass foo minus 1, this part of code will execute. Think about what will happen now. So what will happen is in a language like Python, so the first line of code will execute fine, so you will get a hello here, as we can see here. But the second line of code will throw an exception. It will say that you cannot concatenate string plus integer object because both of them are different types. So you're still getting an exception, you're getting a type error, but that error is happening at the runtime rather than at the compilation time. So static typing does help a lot in finding these kind of bugs, and these bugs do happen, and there are a lot of bugs that happen. And I think if you look at the languages like JavaScript or language like Python, there have been efforts to add types on top of them. I think in Ruby as well, people are trying to add types to these languages as well, so that at compile time we can find a lot of these bugs. So statically typed compiled language do have advantages, and generally they are more performant as well. Reasons being, type checking is done at the compilation time, so you don't have to pay that cost at runtime. I think in languages like Python, they might be doing some optimization at runtime, so they don't have to do anything, so they might be caching few things as well, but you still pay that cost. Knowledge of types allow compiler to produce efficient machine code that helps in Java. So JVM is a very smart machine which does a lot of optimization for you, and that optimization is made possible because of the compilation process and the static typing, and there's no need to interpret code on the fly. Less thing that you have to do in the at the runtime, the faster your code generally is. Now we are done with the statically typed compiled language. Now that we know what kind of language Java is, what main features Java has, let's move on to the how you will write programs in Java. Let's start with the structure of a Java class. If you look at the structure of a Java class, this is more or less the structure of a Java class. We start with the package statement, that what we have at the top. Then we have one or more import statements, so it could be one or more. Then we have a class declaration. Then we have variable constructors, method, nested classes, nested interfaces, enums. So all of them can exist in a class. Let's start with the first thing, which is the package. So all Java classes are part of a package. If you don't specify any package, that means that you're using a default package. You can't have more than one package statement in a class, so you only can have one package statement. Package name should all be lowercase, and they can't start with digits. Package can start with underscore, and I will make use of them, but in future programming you will never find, in your day-to-day work you will never find a package starting with underscore. I am using the code that I will showcase you. I will be using underscore to start off my packages. The reason being is that I want to name my packages in order, so I want to say underscore 01, underscore 02, so they will be shown in a sorted manner in the IDE. So that's the reason I am using underscore. So valid package names are following. So you can have com.zebra.fs101.day01, or you can also have package fs101. So I think this is a better convention that people use. But I also have seen lately that few libraries in Java ecosystem are using just a name of the library as the package. I think one library that I saw is retrofit by Square. They are using their packages as name are just retrofit dot something, or even OKHTTP, which is another library by Square. They also use that. Again, I think it saves some typing effort sometimes. Import statement. So import statement is when you have to use any other class which exists in any other package, any other public class, then you will be using import statement. To use a class or interface from another package, you must use its fully qualified name. So if you don't specify it, so let's suppose you want to use a list interface in your code, one way to do that is that you can use the fully qualified name. So you can say java.util.list, then list equal to new java.util.arrayList. That is one way to do that, or you can import that so that you can just write list equal to new ArrayList. So what I'm saying is, and if we just change this to Java, so one way to do this is you can say java.util.list, which is, let's assume we are building a list of string. This is, again, we have to have java.util.arrayList. That is one way to do that. But if we add the import statement, so we can say that we are using java.util.list and we are also using ArrayList, import both of these, then we can simplify the code. So if I just move it here, so I can say, I can just say now something like this, right? So I now have in my context, I have this, so I don't need to provide the fully qualified names. Okay. There can be zero or many import statements. You don't need to have an import statement. If there is no need, you don't need to. But there could be many import statements as well. And one good practice that you should always keep in mind is that you should also try to clean up the unused imports. In most of the IDEs, you have shortcuts to do that. So try to follow that. So for example, if you are using IntelliJ IDEA, let me just open a small class like this. And let me add an import. Import java.util.list. Let's assume this is, so as you can see in IntelliJ IDEA, you are seeing this import as being grayed out. So normally you can just do code and you can say optimize import and that will go away. So that is a better practice to keep your code clean. So below you can see a package statement along with the two import statements. Let's move on to the next thing, which is the class declaration. I think if you know about classes, so class is the blueprint or specification to create objects. We will be going deeper into it tomorrow, but let's just focus today on the declaration part of it. So class declaration is composed of following. So it will start with the access modifier, like here public is the access modifier. Then you have a non-access modifier like final that you are seeing here. So this is the final that you are seeing here. And then you have a class modifier. This is the class. Then the name of the class like dog, name of a base class like animal, all the interfaces that is implementing right now, only one, but there could be more, and the class body inside the curly braces. One thing that you should always keep in mind is that class name should always be nouns, and they always follow the mixed case, where normally this is called the Pascal case. So Pascal case is this one. So this is Pascal case, this is camel case, this is snake case. Fine. Normally in Java this is for classes and interfaces, even annotations, even enum. So this is what you will be using for. This is normally for variables and methods. This is what you will be using them for. Okay. The worst thing that I find is when people don't name their classes well. Like you can have a class name called dogs. The class names are not plural, they are singular, so you normally will have only a dog class, not a dogs class or users class. You will not have that. Try to keep your class name simple and descriptive. That really helps. Now here I'm showing a package where I'm using underscore, so you can see that underscore 02 underscore day. So I think this will become much more clear if I show you this. So I have, so as you can see, I have source code for different days. So right now this is the underscore 02 day, which is the second day. So now if I just come collapse it, it becomes three packages. I can easily say which day I'm talking about, and I can just directly go to that. So I'm using underscore for this reason, but there's no reason. In actual programming, you don't need most of the time. If Java allowed your variables to have digits, then probably I couldn't have to do this hack. So in Java, there are, as you can see, a Java declaration is composed of lot many things. But what is mandatory is the keyword class, name of the class, and the curly braces. You don't have to specify the access modifier. So if you don't specify, it becomes the default. We will cover that later. You don't even have to specify make your class final. Again, we will cover that in few slides from now. And you don't have to extend any other class. If you don't extend any class, it extends object. And finally, you don't have to implement an interface. So these are all optionals, and in some cases you will have all of them or a few of them. Let's move on to the variables now. Variables are of two types. Either they will be instance or static. So as you can see here, we have a class dog, which has two variables. One is the name, second is the weight. So these are the instance variables of a class because they correspond to the object itself. This is the static variable which belongs to the class. So all the objects of this class dog will share this, but they will have their own copy of the variables, instance variables. Changing the value of an instance variable for an object only changes value for that object, not others. A single copy of a class variable or a static variable is shared by all the objects, as I just talked about. So total dogs is shared by all the dog objects. Instance and static variables should be written in camel case. I just talked about that. If you're creating constants, then they have to be uppercase, right? Hopefully this is clear. Let's move on to the next component of a class. Next thing that you can have in a class, which is the constructor. So constructor is called when you create an object. So when we create a dog object, this constructor will be called. If we just say dog dog equal to new dog Fido, then this will be called. We can also probably add weight of a dog as well. Then this constructor will be called. As you can see that there are two constructors, so I'm reusing the second constructor. So I'm calling the second constructor from the first constructor using this keyword, so that I don't have to repeat this. So I just can call this code and my code will have some reusability. It's a good idea in constructor to do that, if you can do that. A class can have multiple constructors that accept different sets of method parameters. Let's move on to interfaces. So interfaces are mainly for defining the contract of the classes. So it basically mainly talk about the behavior that your class can have. So we have a barkable interface. So it says that anyone who implements barkable will have a bark method. So that would interface is talking about the contract that you have. Till Java 7, you can't have implementations in the interfaces. You can only have abstract methods. You can't have methods which have implementation. But since Java 8, you can have default methods which have implementation. So we will be covering Java 8 parts in week 4 or week 5, something along those. And then I will cover default methods and static methods in a interface. Interfaces should also be capitalized just like class name, so they also are Pascal case. Okay, so let's look at this example code and see what will happen. So what you have to answer is that how can you make this code compile. So this code fails to compile, so you have to find out which of the following options are true. So A is true, I already told you this code fails to compile. Now find out how you can make this code compile, which all options have to be true. Think about all these are part of a single file called multiple java. So the answer are A, C, D. So the A is that code will fail to compile. C is removing the definition of a class car, because you can't have two public classes in a single file. And D is that if I change class car to non-public, it will also compile as well. Okay, move on. Let's move on to the Java packages in depth. So I'll just got a few more things about packages, because they are an important part of the language. A package allows you to group together a set of related classes interface. So this is the first level of grouping that you can have. Since Java 9, we also have modules now, so that also helps. But since I'm not covering Java 9, so we will consider most, we'll focus mainly on the package level encapsulation that we can have. So they provide access protection and namespace management. So you can have two packages, com.zbr.foo and com.zbr.bar, and then you can have the same class, let's suppose user, in both of them. So there'll be no namespace collision in that. They give us a logical way to group our code. So you can have different packages focused on different things, specific things. They provide encapsulation boundaries, so you can hide stuff behind them. One thing that I try is that I don't make my classes public. I can only make my interfaces public, so that I can nobody knows which implementation is getting used behind the scene. All classes and interfaces are defined in a package. If they don't include an explicit package statement in a class, then they are part of a default package. Packages are all about helping us solve the name collision. The usual naming convention, or the one naming convention that is popular in Java, is this. So you start with the reverse domain name. So like if we are using zbr.com, so we start with com.zbr, then we'll talk about the name of the application. So in our case, it is just a course that we're talking about. Then the sub packaging, so right now I'm talking about day 01, so that becomes the sub categorization of a package. So this is the naming convention that normally you will use. Package rules, I think most of them are already covered, so they have to be in lowercase. Sub packages are separated by a dot. Package names follow the valid identifier, so you can't start them with a digit. For classes interface defined in a package, package statement has to be the first statement, so you can't have package statement move or place any other way in any other location. There can be only one package statement in a Java file. All classes interfaces defined in a single source code file have the same package. So if I go back to my code and let's just remove all of this, let's assume that I create a package foo, and I create a class A, and I create a class B, and an interface, let's suppose C, then all of them are part of the same package, is the package foo. That's what it means. So I can't have something like this is not valid, so I can't have package bar or package bar something, and I can't have that. Fine. If you have some experience with building web application, I'm sure you would have seen this kind of a structure in your code. So you normally have your application name, then you normally have controllers, where all the controllers are of your application, or all the servlets of your application are. Then you have a package for DAO, then you have a package for services. So this is a common layer architecture, layer based packaging that we normally see in source code of different applications. But there's another way to structure your code as well. I think the better practice is to either structure your code by functionality or by type. So right now we're talking about, we have four types in our application. We have order, report, store, and user. So we have packages for them, and under them, order will have all the controller corresponding to order, all the services, all the DAO, and that becomes the unit of encapsulation of order entity. tomorrow, I think if you are aware of something called microservices, if you package, if you have functional packages or type-based packages, then you can, it will be much more easier for you to take this package and convert it to a microservice than in the layered-based architecture where you are everywhere. This allows you to hide implementation details through package visibility. So I can just have an interface of a package component being exposed here, and then those can only be used in my other packages. We will talk about that later. Let's talk about the access modifier. So Java has four access modifier: public, private, protected, and default. So access modifier control the visibility, the accessibility of a class or interface, including its members, by other classes or other interface in the same package or separate package. A class can only have two of them. One is the public, so you can just define a class name public, or you can have the default. Default means it can only be accessed within the package only. So for a class, the only thing that makes sense is public and default. So default is not here. For class variables, you can have all of them. For instance variable, you can have all of them. Method parameters don't have anything. So how can we make a class A talk to class B? So the first part is, can class A access class B? So class A is part of package. So assume these are two different files. So one file is this, second file is this. So these are two separate files, not the same file. How can I make class A access class B? So right now it will not be able to do that until you make the class B public. So class B, oh, there is an error here. So there are two S's here. It should be three S's here. There should be only two. Public access modifier, classes interface is defined using the public access modifier, accessible across all the packages from derived to unrelated. You have to be very careful when you are trying to make something public. So once you make something public, that becomes part of your public API, so you can't get away from it. So without breaking the compatibility of your clients, you can't get away from it. Protected. So protected is all about, it's also either part of the same package or something that you inherit. So classes interface defined in the same package can access it, or all derived classes even if they are in separate packages. So either I have to inherit it or it has to be in the same package. So this is what we are saying. Directly, either they have to be in the same package or in the separate package, but then you have to use inheritance. Default access, the members of a class defined without any explicit access modifier. this is applicable to classes as well, and methods and interface, everything. The default access is also called the package private, which means that it will only be accessible in a package only, not outside the package. I recommend that when you're creating a class, start by making it default. Until you know that you really have to make something public, you should be using the default access. Private is that only the members within the class can access it. No one outside the class can access it. Now that we know the access modifier, which controls the accessibility of different components, now let's talk about non-access modifier. So non-access modifier are many. So we have abstract, fine, static, but there are also like synchronized, volatile, transient, and others. So in this video, I'm only talking about these three because they are currently relevant to you. If required, we will cover others as well when required. So we'll start with the abstract, final, and static. So abstract is keyword can be used with either of the three. So you can either have a method abstract, a class abstract, or interface abstract. Interface are always abstract, so there is no need for it, so it's a redundant thing. You don't have to specify. If you make something an abstract method, then they can't have a body, which means that other class has to extend them and provide their implementation. An abstract class is something, again, which we are saying that you want somebody to inherit. Or this is very useful. Abstract classes are also useful when you are building static utility libraries as well. So I think most of us have seen classes like dateUtils or collectionUtil or whatever util. It is always a good idea to make them abstract, because when you make something in abstract, it means that it can't be instantiated. So if you make a class abstract, it can't be instantiated. So it's also a good idea to make utility classes abstract. I think that's the worst thing that we can see, is that an abstract class being injected in the source code, or an instance being people trying to get an instance of it. Or I think it's normally the bad thing that I see normally is that people create util classes, but then they add instance as well as static methods in them. They are also injecting those classes in other classes, and it really becomes a mess. So just make them abstract and you will get away from most of the disadvantages. Final access modifier can be used with a class, variable or method. When you make a class final, it means that it can't be extended by any other class. A final variable means that it can't be reassigned a value. A final method means that it can't be overridden by a derived class. So I think this is very useful, and you will see that in action. Usually when you try to create something immutable, we use final. We'll cover that later. Static non-access modifier. So the non-access modifier can be applied to a declaration of variables, method and classes. So you can have static inner classes. Static means that something belongs to a class. It is shared across all the objects. Exist independently of any instance, so they are all shared. Static methods aren't associated with the object and can't be used. Can't use any of the instance variable of a class as well. So like main method is a static method, so you can't directly access the state of the class using from this main method. You can't do that. Static method variable can't access the instance member of the class as well. And that is already covered. Okay, this is a fun question. Think about it. So what you have is a dog reference which is pointing to null, and then you're saying dog dot total dogs, and this is the declaration of a dog. So total dogs is a static variable, and then you have two private variables. So we already saw that. So the answer is zero, not the null pointer exception. A lot of people think that it should throw null pointer exception because we are calling dog dot. But again, because it's a static reference, instance just doesn't matter right now. So it will be the zero will be printed. If you look at this code in your IntelliJ, so if I just showcase that, so IntelliJ will say that, so you're trying to call a static member in a instance mode, or in a, just like you are calling a instance variable, but it will show you a yellow line. So static member accessed by instance reference normally. So that will show you that something is wrong. But I have seen a lot of developers who don't care about all these warnings that IntelliJ shows to people. So people still might miss it. I think that's it for today. Hope you enjoyed this lecture. So what we covered is Java is a statically typed compiled language. We covered about the structure of a class. We talked about what a package, import statement, class declaration interface means. We also covered access modifier, and then we also covered three non-access modifier. I think that's where we will end today. Hope you enjoyed the session. Tomorrow we will start getting deeper into other things.